Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, my dear brothers and sisters. We will continue, inshallah, talking about the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, taking segments from his beautiful, beautiful life. May Allah allow us to see him in the afterlife. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. So we stopped last time about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sending the message of Islam to as many people as possible. The wars with Quraysh have settled. Yes, there are some battles and scrimmages here and there outside of that, but to the most part, the biggest enemy towards them, Quraysh, things have settled, alhamdulillah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's no avenue to tell people about God, to tell people about the truth, to tell people that which is good, to warn people of that which is bad, except that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have taken. And now he will send a message all the way to the Roman Empire. Yes, the grand empire of the Romans, he will send a note there. And to the Persian Empire, and to the king of Abyssinia. And brother, the king of Abyssinia, is he not Muslim? That is correct. But after some time, when Amr ibn al-As moved back, the Muslims came back, and Najashi has passed away. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed for al-Najashi. And now there is another Najashi, and that's the title of the leaders of Abyssinia. So a new king comes there, also sending him a note. And every, when kul jababirati al-ard, all the leaders around the world, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whoever he's able to send a letter to, he sends it. And this is something about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and about Islam. Allah says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. We have not sent you, O Muhammad, except mercy to all beings, not just the Arab, not just this, and no, to all beings. Wallahi, His mercy even to the animals, His mercy to even to the trees. May Allah grant us all mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And another thing to show you about Islam, brothers and sisters, Islam is not just applicable to Arabs in Arabia. He is sending it to people of different culture, people of different ethnicity, people of different education, different language. That's all fine. Islam can coexist with all of this. And whatever is negative, then you are to adjust it according to Islam. This is something to truly appreciate. Islam is applicable to every place and every time. So with that being said, brothers and sisters, this is a suggestion. This is a lesson to take from the Prophet ﷺ, is to convey the message of Islam. Number one, I'll share with you 5 points. Number one, because it's not just the job of the prophets. It's your job and my job within our capacity. How is it my job? The Prophet ﷺ said, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Tell people about me. Tell people about Islam. Tell people about the truth, even if all what you know was one verse. Even if what you know is one sentence. Go and share it with others. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us. You share it assuming you know what it means. You know when it's to be applied and so on and so forth. And don't say, please, don't say, as long as I'm practicing, as long as I pray to Allah, that's what matters, not what other people do. Listen, this sentence can be correct after you try to convey the message to others. At that point, then as long as, you know, fashhadu, then bear witness we're Muslim, then that's where you content with that. But until you convey to others, that's where you do all the job that you can possibly do. Look at this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gives the example of two groups. Group one, people who worship Allah and know the rulings. And the other group, people who do not worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or fulfill their duties and obligations. He says these two groups, they enter into a ship, a boat. The ones who follow Allah's commands and rulings, they are in the upper level. They know Islam, they know the signs, all that stuff. They are where? The upper level. To them, there's no ceiling. To them, they can see the ocean, they can see the sky. The ones who do not know about the religion, about the truth, they took the lower level. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the ones in the lower level, when they wanted water, they said to one another, let us not disturb the ones in the upper floor. So let's just dig a hole into our boat and we can get the water from it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if the people in the upper level do not give a helping hand, do not make sure that this stops, they all will drown. You see that? all will drown. It's not because, oh, you are in the top, you have access to water. You know what? I know the religion, that's what matters. No, if you do not advise those below, all of you will drown. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and if the ones in the top, they help the ones in the bottom, all of them will be saved. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow me and you to be among people who save others. And the other thing about the 5 points is to convey within your capabilities. We're not calling for all people to be scholars, all people sorry, to be speakers, to be lecturers, to be preachers. No, that's not the call. What's your capacity at this point? What can you provide? You are a physician that has your own, you have your own practice. What do you see? Magazines of fashion and cars? Why not put some stuff about Islam? That's your capacity at this point. Maybe other things you can do. What about someone who's younger, who's very good at writing? We need your writing skills to help us. Someone is great at videotaping. Alhamdulillah, that's a capacity. Great, I cannot do it without Allah and then the wonderful brother and the team that helped put this together. And the ones who, the ICD and the masajid and all you people. May Allah grant you all Jannah. This teamwork. What's your capacity? I'm really good at marketing. Bismillah, we need it so badly. Each one has the capacity. And wallahi, if all what you can do is to practice your religion in terms of character and behavior, that in itself is da'wah. That in itself is the conveying of the message of Islam. Look at this wonderful reflection from the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent a group of the companions to Najd, the east side of Arabia, to go like as spying, because remember, it's like a war zone, there's still some battles and scrimmages outside of Medina, and they captured the leader who was known as Thumama ibn Uthal. Thumama, when he was captured, the companions, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked him to tie Thumama, where do I tie him? In one of the pillars in the masjid. You see that? In one of the pillars in the masjid. When they tied him, the Prophet ﷺ came to Thumama. He said, "Ma عندك يا Thumama." So what's new, Thumama? What you got? Changed your mind? You admit I'm the Prophet of Allah? You admit this is the truth? You agree what you're doing, for example, is wrong? So the Prophet asked him, "Ma عندك? What's new with you? Anything changed?" So Thumama says 3 things. He says, this is what I have to tell you. Number one, إِن تَقْتُلْ تَقْتُلْ ذَا دَمْ. If you wish to kill me, then know that my blood is expensive. I got people who will come after you. If you release me, then I'm a grateful person and I will thank you for that. And number three, if all what you want is money, ask however money you want and I will give it to you. So the Prophet ﷺ left him and he walked away. Second day, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked Thumama, "Ma عندك?" Huh? Anything changed? By the way, I want you to keep in mind something. Thumama is seeing the Muslims in the masjid. Thumama is hearing the Quran recitation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine hearing the recitation of the Prophet of Allah alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thumama is seeing the cheerful face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thumama is seeing the companions dealing with one another. Thumama is seeing how the women are being respected and honored. Thumama is seeing the overall community and society and what lectures are being given and what advice is given to one another. Thumama are perhaps seeing marriages being, the contracts being written in the masajid. Second day, Thumama, what you got? Anything new? Any change of mind? He says, I give you the same exact options. If you kill me, my blood is expensive. If you free me, I'm very grateful. I will never forget the good you've done to me. And if what you want is money, ask me, how much do you want? And I'll give it all for you. Thumama is a big, big, big shot. They are a major wheat distributors to the Arabian Peninsula. The Prophet ﷺ leaves him. Third day. Ah, Thumama, anything new? And Thumama gives the exact same answer, all three. Then the Prophet ﷺ, what does he say? Kill him? La. What does he say? He says to the companions, أطلقوا ثمامة, release him. You're good to go, you're free. Untied ثمامة, got up and he left. Check this out. ثمامة, when he left, brothers and sisters, left the masjid, he went outside the area a little bit and there was a water area where he was able to take a shower. Took a shower, washed up, looked fresh. And then, where did he go? back to the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ. People are shocked, obviously. What brought you back? He came back and he saw the Prophet ﷺ. And look what he said. Ya Muhammad, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Allahu Akbar. Look what he says. He says three things. Number one, he says, Ya Muhammad, there's no face I hated, no human being I hated more than you. And today, you are the most beloved human being to me. He says, Ya Muhammad, there's no religion that I hated and looked down upon more than Islam. And today, Islam is the most beloved religion to me. He said, Ya Muhammad, there's no land in the world that I hated more than this land, which I'm here at right now. I hated it. And today, this is the most beloved land to me. Ya Allah. What did he say? What da'wah, what did he receive? He saw the interaction of Muslims. Convey the message of Islam within your capability and capacity. May Allah allow us to practice Islam. Wallahi, one of the strongest ways to give da'wah. What comes to mind, subhanAllah. I was flying, and sometimes we fail, as I said before, but we'll share with you stories that perhaps may Allah accept from us. I was traveling, and I saw a guy wearing gloves, wearing a mask, face mask, and sitting in the airplane. I was a bit maybe worried. I'm like, maybe he is sick and so on. So I looked at him, said hi, greeted him, and I said, everything is good? He's like, yeah, listen, I'm not sick. I'm actually scared of being sick. So, you know, we had a couple comments, sentences. We had good time, just a very brief. And then there was a cart being pushed that has food on it. And it was a long flight, about 5 hours. So then they were selling the food. It was not for free. And the guy asked, how much is it? And it was a decent price, nothing ridiculously expensive. It was in the middle. So he was hesitant to buy. And right away, I said, let's use this opportunity. And I told the flight attendant, you know what? Get me this sandwich, if you don't mind, please. And also, I want to take care of his sandwich. So he's like, oh, you don't have to. I said, no, it's fine. So we got the sandwich, passed it on to him. And I got my sandwich. And now we broke bread together. We start eating. So where are you going? Where are you traveling? Yeah, I'm going to this place. Why? I'm going to teach a class about Islamic code of ethics. So he said, oh, that's pretty cool. Look what he said. Allah's my witness. He said, you know what? This whole thing about Muslims on the news is not true. SubhanAllah, over a sandwich, right? May Allah guide him to that which is truth. I mean, not just over a sandwich in that way. I'm not degrading the guy. May Allah honor him and guide him to that which is true. But just to see the softening of the heart, that sentence, this heart softening has changed. He said, you know what? You Muslims are good people. All of that, SubhanAllah. May Allah accept from all of us. Brothers and sisters, the point being is that the practice of Islam, doing things like that, what did the Prophet teach us? Remember what we said, the hadith? The first thing the Prophet gave when he came to Medina, the first lecture he gave in Medina, what did he say? At'imu at'am, feed the people. There's something about feeding people, right? SubhanAllah. May Allah make you and I practice Islam as much as possible. And may Allah forgive us, because wallahi, sometimes we may show Islam not in a good way. I pray to Allah to forgive us on these days. Don't be the one who puts a bumper sticker on your car, Islam, you know, is the truth, and then you drive horrible, right? Some people, they say Allah is one, and they cut red lights, cut stop signs. What kind of religion is this? So watch out how you convey the da'wah. May Allah grant us wisdom. Amin Rabbil Alameen. So number one, convey, because it's not just the job of the prophets, but it's our job. Number two, convey within your capacity. What to also share with you, when you convey the message of Islam, be as respectful and humble as possibly as you can. Respect. Don't look down upon people. People have a chance. Have adab and akhlaq. Look what Allah says. Allah says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أدع إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن. Allah says, call people to the path of Allah. How? With wisdom. Know what to say, when to say it, how to say it, why you're saying it, and all these things play factor. May Allah grant us wisdom. Then Allah says, with good akhlaq, والموعظة الحسنة. And if you ever have to argue or debate or have a discussion, بالتي هي أحسن, with good character. Allahu Akbar. And look what Rasulullah said. This is a warning, especially those who are very excited with the da'wah, inviting people to Islam. Even the smaller things, as in, that's right, that's bad. the way you say it to your family, to your friends, with good akhlaq. Look what the Prophet said. This is a warning. This is a warning. He said, وَإِنَّ سُوءَ الْخُلُقِ, bad character, يُفْسِدُ الْعَمَلِ, ruins the deed the same way vinegar ruins the honey. So you might do great work. You know, you're already spending the time, you know, preparing the way to speak and the content and all that stuff. You have an event, setting up the tables, the chairs, putting all these great things and putting the work to tell people Islam. You want to advise your friend, your mom, dad, sister, brother. But the way you're doing it is not good. In a horrible character, horrible behavior. All that effort, gone to waste. That's what the Prophet said. Su al-khuluq, bad character, can ruin the deed. May Allah protect us. You come with respect. Don't look down upon people. Keep in mind your capacity. Share with you this story. One of the mashayikh, one of our teachers, he tells us, there was a German boxer who came to Riyadh to be awarded in a ceremony. There was a Muslim sister in Saudi Arabia. When she saw this opportunity to deliver da'wah, she came with respect, didn't look down upon the person, humbleness. She came and gave him a Quran translated into German. Who tells us the story, by the way? The German boxer himself, he shares it, and that's how we got the story. Then he goes back to Germany. 20 years later, 20 sana, he says, I was cleaning my library and I came across this book. I saw it, Quran translated into German language. He opened it and he remembered it was that lady, that sister, wore modest clothing. She came, gave it to me. He read the Quran and he said, Islam entered my heart. Allahu Akbar. And he accepted Islam. He went to an Islamic center in Germany, declared his Islam, and look what do you think he did. What do you think comes to mind about one of the first things he did? Within the first week or so, and Allah knows best, he asked, any pamphlets do you have? Any booklets, any brochures, anything I can have, like da'wah material to tell people about Islam so I can learn and teach, I can learn and teach? They said, sure, and they gave him. So this brother, he goes to the city center downtown in his area. He sets up a table, a booth, and he has all that material, content about Islam, on the table. People, men and women, they start coming to him. Why? To take pictures, to take autographs, because he is famous, he's known in this area. People looked up to him. So the people, they come, oh, can I have a picture, autograph? He comes, he said, yeah, sure. And then he said, by the way, please take this pamphlet. Please take this book. Allah is my witness. In 1 year, more than 100 people accepted Islam. Subhanallah. All that reward is in whose scale? Inshallah, in that brother's scale. But who as well? That sister who gave out the Quran. And the reward that brother got and that sister got and all of us are getting is in whose scale? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah grant us wisdom. The fourth point as well we learn from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is when you convey the message of Islam, keep in mind the reward. We need that motivation, right? We need that motivation, the reward that we get. How about I share with you two things? Number one, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever tells people about that which is good or warns people of that which is bad and they actually end up listening to your advice, you get the reward of what they do. So for example, someone is reading Quran, making a mistake. So I go and correct my brother, you know what, that's not how you read it, just that's how you pronounce it, and they fix the recitation. Anytime they read Quran, if Allah accepts, he gets the reward, and I get the reward for every time he reads that, subhanAllah. And this motivation. You know, at work, I remember when we first got my first job, they told us, now that you're hired, if you help us get another engineer, we give you $1,000 as a referral bonus, right? Because you're bringing someone and we are motivated. We tell you, please buy this book using this link because you'll get this discount or get this coupon back. This is unworldly dunya stuff. Imagine in akhirah, in the afterlife. Brothers and sisters, the other reward, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam makes dua. Makes dua. What does he say? نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ إِمْرَأَ إِمْرَأً, may Allah beautify the face of the person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless the face of that person. Who is that person, Ya Rasulullah? Who is he praying for? The one who hears something about this deen, about this religion, and then conveys it to people, Ya Allah. And maybe you, if Allah, may Allah grant sincerity, you hear something in this lecture, you go forward it to others. This is your halal makeup tutorial, right? Just go convey the message of Islam, and Allah will beautify your face. You'll be someone who is appealing to people. May Allah grant it to you, grant it to me, and grant it to all of us. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. This is the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Last but not least, when you convey the message, and there's a lot more points to say, but just to summarize, when you convey the message, I want you, inshallah, and I remind myself, focus on the effort. Focus on the effort and leave the results on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what does he say? Say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, if one of you was holding a small plant, fasila, small plant, and the day of judgment was taking place, imagine, the sky is being split, the oceans turning into fire, the moon and the sun, their lights are basically going off and hitting one another and everything going out of control. This is taking place. What do I do with the plant? Drop it and pray? No. Plant that small plant. But who's going to eat from it? How long will it take to grow? Who will benefit? See, now you're talking about results. Leave the results on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you focus on the what? The effort. That's something to keep in mind. May Allah protect us, may Rabbil Alameen. So we do everything and we rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of that we learn from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So out of all the letters the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam he sent to so many leaders, I would like to talk about one specific scenario, one specific story and letter which was sent to Heraclius, Heracl, the leader of the Roman Empire. Heraclius, brothers and sisters, or Heracl, was a very, very educated person about religion. He was a scholar of his own in terms of religion. So the Prophet ﷺ, he sent Dihya al-Kalbi, he was one of the companions, with this letter to go all the way and to make sure it's delivered to Heraclius. So he gives it to one of the leaders and eventually it comes to Heraclius' hands. Heraclius, look what he says. He asked the question, he said, is there anyone in this area? Now we're talking about Asham, where the Roman Empire was at that time. He said, is there anyone in the area who knows Muhammad on a personal level? They said, yes, there is. In this area, yes, there is. How? There's a man named Abu Sufyan. And if you remember, Abu Sufyan, it was a big, big enemy to Islam at that time. He is actually in Asham doing some business and trade. So he came with a group of his friends and businessmen. So he said, bring him on. So the messenger of Heraclius goes to Abu Sufyan. He tells them, there's an invitation. We need you to come to Heraclius to go. He wants to ask you some questions. Can you imagine you having an invite to meet the leader of the Roman Empire? So Abu Sufyan goes. And then the Heraclius individual, or the Heracl, he tells his translator, go ask. Now the team is here. Who amongst them is the closest? So Abu Sufyan says, I am the closest. Look what Heraclius does. Ready? He says to Abu Sufyan, come forward. Few steps forward. The rest, stay behind. So all of them are from Mecca or businessmen. But Abu Sufyan, I want you to be the only one that comes forward. Heraclius tells the other people, I will ask Abu Sufyan certain questions. If he lies on any of the questions, if he lies on anything, give me a sign, any gesture, so I know he's a liar. Subhanallah, Abu Sufyan says, this authentic narration, he says, if it wasn't that they may show a sign that I'm lying, I would have lied on every single question to ruin the image of Muhammad and Islam, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But he said, I don't want to be called a liar. If a disbeliever at that time was worried about being called a liar, then what about you and I who says La ilaha illallah? Should we not be worried about what Allah will say about us? May Allah make you and I among those who say nothing but the truth. Say Ameen. Ameen Rabbal Alameen. So Abu Sufyan decides, okay, I'll not lie. And look what happens. Ready? Heraclius will ask Abu Sufyan 9 questions. All the 9, what is it about? Or what are they about? All 9 questions are about the messenger, not the message yet. He asked him, number one, he said, how is the lineage of the man who claims to be a prophet? How is his lineage like? So Abu Sufyan says, honestly, he comes from a very, very respected family. You know, from Quraysh, from that very noble family, respected, all that good stuff. Question number two. Has there been a king among his ancestors? Like, does he come from a king or so on and so forth? He says, no. There's no kings in his lineage. Number three. Did you ever accuse Muhammad, the one who claims to be a prophet, did you ever accuse him to be a liar before he said, I'm a prophet? Now remember something with me. How old was the Prophet ﷺ when he said, I received revelation from God? How old was he? He wasn't 15, he wasn't 25, he wasn't 35, he was 40 years old. 40 years old. So Abu Sufyan said, before he said he was a prophet, i.e. before age of 40, from birth to 40, did he ever lie? Did you ever accuse him of lying? Abu Sufyan said, no. Now, the fourth question, Heraclius asks Abu Sufyan, who are his followers? Are they more of the upper class, elite, rich, or more of the lower, humble class? Abu Sufyan says, they are more of the lower, humble class. Yes, there were the elite, but the majority, the lower, humble class. So question number five, are his followers increasing in numbers or are they decreasing in numbers? Abu Sufyan says, they are increasing in numbers. Okay, question number six. The ones who embrace Islam and they accept Islam, so that these numbers, do they eventually, when they accept, they just leave after some time, they apostate and let go of the religion, they're not happy with it? Abu Sufyan says, no. Whoever accepts Islam, to the most part, they just stay as Muslims. Number seven, have you ever been at war with him? Did you ever fight him in a battle? Abu Sufyan says yes. So Heraqil gives a follow-up on this one. He says, how were the results like? So Abu Sufyan said there were battles where we won, we beat them, such as Uhud. And there were battles where they beat us, such as Badr. So then question number eight, has he, the man who claims to be a prophet, has he ever, from now, from birth all the way beyond prophethood, how old is the prophet now? The prophet, roughly speaking, roughly, is perhaps 60 years old, approximately, 59, 60, and Allah knows best. So all these years, 60 years, did he ever, since you're the closest person to him, right? So you dealt with him on a many bases. Did he ever break one promise? Did he ever breach any covenant? Abu Sufyan said, not a single time, no. Abu Sufyan said, however, there's a treaty going on. Remember what treaty that is? The one we spoke about previous session, Hudaybiyah. He said, we have a treaty going on right now. I don't know what he will do in this one. Abu Sufyan says afterwards, this was the only thing I can input to kind of throw shade at Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as in make Heraclius like, maybe there's a chance of him breaching the covenant. He says, that's the only thing I could have said. The last question, number nine. He said, did anyone, is it a trend with you in Quraysh, in Mecca, in your area? Is it a thing that people come up, pop up? I'm a prophet. Oh, I'm a prophet. No, I'm the prophet. Is that a trend that people go through in your area? Abu Sufyan said, no, it's not a common thing. Heraclius now, and may Allah bless you for your patience, Heraclius now will give nine responses to the questions he asked, as in why he asked it. Number one, Heraclius said, I asked you about his lineage, and you said he comes from a noble, respected lineage. And that is a fact about all prophets. Every single prophet comes from a noble lineage. Number two, I asked you if any of his ancestors was a king. You said no. If you said yes, I would have thought maybe Muhammad is claiming that one thing to get the kingdom back, and he wants to be a king. But that's not the case, according to what you said. Number three, I asked you whether his followers are more of the upper elite or more of the lower and humble. And he said, no, lower and humble. And that's the thing about prophets. The majority of their followers are on the poorer side, the lower status and the humble in that society. Number four, I asked you, did you ever accuse him of being a liar before he said he was a prophet? Did you ever accuse him? You said, no. And I said to myself, he never lied about the people all his life. Never lied about people. Now he will lie about God. SubhanAllah. Number five, I asked you if any of the people that follow him end up renouncing the faith and they end up letting go of the faith. You said no, they stick to the faith. And that too is a sign of the truth, because the truth gains more followers. I asked you, this question is what? Number seven. I asked you whether you had been at war with him. And you said, yes, sometimes you won and sometimes he won. And that too is a sign of prophethood. How? Because prophets, sometimes they win and God also tests them with difficulty when they lose. Allahu Akbar. Number eight, I asked you whether he ever broke a promise, whether he ever violated a covenant. And you said no. And that's a trait, a character about prophets. They never in their life break one promise. La ilaha illallah. May Allah make us like that and follow the footsteps of the prophets. Ameen. Number nine, I asked you, has anyone ever claimed to be a prophet of God in your area? And you said no. If you said yes, people pop up, yeah, I'm a prophet, I'm a prophet. I would have said maybe it's a fashion, it's a fad in your area, and it's a common thing. But he said no. Look what Heraclius does now. He asked nine questions about what? About the messenger. Now he asked one question only about what? The message itself. He says, what does he teach? What are the teachings of his religion? And Abu Sufyan shares six things in this one authentic narration. He says, he tells us to worship none but Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth, and not to associate anyone besides God. Like, don't associate anyone with God. So don't worship idols. Don't do any of these type of rituals that associate others with God. Number two, he tells us to pray. You know, the prayers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make you and I steadfast upon the five daily prayers. Say ameen. Number three, he tells us to zakah, which is to give charity to the less fortunate and other, the correct categories in which the obligatory charity is to be given to. And he tells us to always say the truth and never lie. And he teaches us al-afaf, modesty and chastity, to be respectful and modest in your speech, in your clothing, in your walk, in your behavior. And he teaches us as-sila. What's sila? To have strong family ties, to be good to our family, so on and so forth. You see what Islam is? May Allah allow you and I that when we tell people about the truth and Islam, we are as clear as possible, like the Prophet ﷺ. Look how the enemy knows about Islam, as great as it looks like, subhanAllah, at that time. Then, brothers and sisters, Heraclius will give his conclusion. Ready? That's his conclusion. He said, if what you said is the truth, and remember, not a single one in the back made a sign that Abu Sufyan is lying, not one. He said, if what you said is the truth, and by the way, if that's the case, he is certainly a prophet. La ilaha illallah. If what you said is true, he, Muhammad, is certainly a prophet. And if I can, but the thing about me, is that I never knew that he will come and appear from amongst you. We knew, as scholars, we knew the final prophet is coming, but we never knew he will be amongst you, i.e. the Arab. Then he said, if I'm able to reach to him, what, Heraclius, the Roman Empire, the leader, wants to go to Muhammad SAW? Not just go, listen to this. He said, if I get the chance to go all the way to him and have the honor of meeting him, I would go as far as washing his feet, the feet of the Prophet. Allahu Akbar. Then he tells Abu Sufyan, his dominion, the dominion of Muhammad SAW and his rulership and leadership and Islam will spread as far as taking my spot right here. Islam will go all the way to take over the Roman Empire. Yes. Then Heraclius commands the letter to be brought. The letter, yes. The letter is brought. And then it's read. Ready? The letter is somewhat short, relatively speaking, shorter than our lectures and our da'wah, right to the point. And surely the Prophet ﷺ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. I will not say surely, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best how Heraclius is known amongst the Arab that he's also very educated religiously. So the Prophet ﷺ says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the Most Merciful, the Beneficent, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Look what he says. From Muhammad. This letter is from who? From Muhammad, the messenger of God. Shuf, humbleness. The messenger of God. To, so the letter is from the Prophet, to whom? What will he say? To the deviant? To the disbeliever? to the corrupted leader? What do you say? لا, استغفرالله. He says, إلى هرقل عظيم الروم, respecting. He says to Heraclius, the grand emperor of the Roman Empire, respect the status. Look how you deal with people. Someone of such status, you appreciate that. Imagine you go to someone who is a big leadership and you go right away, just cuss at them, disrespect their position, no mentioning of titles, depending on the situation. May Allah grant us wisdom. To Heraclius, the emperor of the Roman Empire, he says, As-salamu ala man ittaba al-huda, peace be upon him who follows guidance and follows the truth. Amma ba'd, after this, with this introduction being said, I extend to you the invitation to accept Islam, submission to Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth. Then he says, embrace Islam and you will be safe. May Allah grant you safety. I'm telling that dua to you. The Prophet says, embrace Islam and you'll be safe. What does it mean? Safety in this life and inshallah safety in the afterlife. Then he says, accept Islam and God will give you double the reward. Why double the reward? The scholars teach us because Heraclius truly believed in Jesus as a prophet of Allah. So you having this belief, you get rewarded for it. And now that you live to see the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, I mean seeing it as in witnessing his narration and his existence, you believe in that, you get another reward. So double the reward. So that's hope, right? Now fear. Then the Prophet ﷺ says, peace be upon him, if you turn away and you do not accept Islam, then you will be held accountable for the sins, not just of yours, the sins of your subjects, of your citizens. Why is that? Just an FYI. Because Heraclius, the leader, and that's a tradition, when the leader makes a move, many followers move with them. They go right. If he turns right, they turn right. If he turns left, they turn left. So the Prophet ﷺ says, if you reject, you are responsible, not just of your own, but you're also responsible at the influence which you will cause towards the people under you. Then the Prophet ﷺ ends the letter with a verse from the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Ahlal Kitab, O people of the book, respect, people of the book, the Jews and the Christians. Ta'alaw ila kalimatin sawa'in baynana wa baynakum. Let's come to common terms. What are the common terms? Alla na'buda illa Allah wa la nushrika bihi shay'a, that we worship no one but Allah. And don't associate anyone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا يَتَّخِذَ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا أَرْبَابًا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. And what else? That we don't take another as lords instead of Allah. And then the end of the verse, and if you turn away, فَاشْهَدُوا what? فَقُولُوا اشْهَدُوا بِأَنَّ مُسْلِمُونَ. Then we are Muslims, we submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this. Reaction. What's the reaction of the people around? They're shocked. Sound. Chaos. Yelling. What's going on? Abu Sufyan doesn't understand what's going on, the language. So then the command comes, أخرجوهم, Abu Sufyan and the people. Okay, thank you. Leave. And they shut the doors. Abu Sufyan is shocked. He said, look at this Muhammad guy. Look at this Muhammad guy having this impact and influence. Even the Heraclius, the Roman Empire leader, is scared of him. Brothers and sisters, Heraclius, look what he says to the people. Ready? He said, O people, pay attention to what he says. He says, O people, he invited everybody. Everybody's assembled. What's going on? Do you wish for permanent, not temporary, permanent success and guidance? That your kingdom should remain with you? You want safety, security, civilization, the greatest of this life? And inshallah, the afterlife basically? When he said that, what does that mean? They got the point. The people in the assembly, they got the point. That means that Heraclius has believed and accepted Muhammad as a prophet. So they ran towards the doors. Opening the doors, guess what? The doors were locked. The doors were locked. So Heraclius calls all of them to come back. Come back. He said, great. I'm very proud of you. I just wanted to test you. Test us? Yes, to test you to see the strength of your faith and adherence to your religion. And then he became very pleased with them. And what a sad moment that is. Wallahi, what a sad moment. Heraclius recognized it. And he told Abu Sufyan, if that, what you said is the truth, yet he chose this life over the afterlife. And many times you and I will go through this. You have opportunities. to do that which is good, but you're nervous, you're worried about what people will say, and so on and so forth. May Allah grant us wisdom and grant us strength. How many people say, you know what? I cannot stop selling alcohol in my store. Why can you not stop? Because it's the money maker. That's how I make my money. Why? But you know what's wrong. Trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will protect you. Allah will preserve you. You have to think of that to motivate you. Someone is concerned about what people think. Sure, be concerned about what people think. Yes, try to please the people. Sure, but never at the expense of displeasing Allah the way Heraclius just did right here. May Allah forgive us and protect us. Brothers and sisters, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent letters across the globe to whoever he can access and have this letter sent to. He did, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he adjusted his invitation in a way that whatever works within the guidelines. I'll give you an example. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, when he was having the letter set and someone writing it for him, he wanted to share it with other leaders. But guess what he was told? He was told the leaders of such caliber in such places do not read a letter unless it is sealed. There has to be a seal on the letter. The Prophet ﷺ was able to be flexible with that? Was he able to be easygoing with that and adopt a seal and so on? Yes, he was. Because if this will promote the message of Islam to be sent properly, correctly, not at the expense of displeasing Allah, then so be it. Go for it, inshallah. Be flexible when possible. But once again, never at the expense of what? Displeasing Allah. He got a ring made from silver. On it is Muhammad Rasulullah. And then he sealed the letters with such seal and he spread it all across. Our job, your job, the job of the believers, the job of those who knew what's good or know what's good and conveying the message and warning that which is wrong. Your job is to convey and not to convert. Converting to Islam, that's a blessing. Alhamdulillah, we want the best for everybody in the world. But our job is to convey with respect and so on. Brothers and sisters, there's danger happening. Danger, why? The treaty is at risk. Hudaybiyah, something went wrong. Something is about to take place that is so risky, about to ruin that treaty. What is that thing? We'll tell you, inshallah, in the next session. Once again, I truly thank you for your patience. Jazakumullah khair. May Allah bless you and reward you. And we'll talk to you, inshallah, in the next session. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.